I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to establish the five main laws of rational trigonometry. So I hope you've already looked at the previous videos. Today's video is very important, and you need to follow everything that we do step by step. Okay. First, let's summarize what we already know. If you have two points, A1 and A2, then the quadrance between them is, by definition, the area of a square built on that segment. That's the square of the usual distance. If you have two lines, then the spread between them is a ratio of two quadrances. An opposite quadrance divided by a hypotenuse quadrance in any right triangle containing those two lines. Now, in previous videos, we've established the two main laws of the subject already. They are Pythagoras' theorem. You have a triangle like this, then that's a right angle, or these are lines are perpendicular, precisely when this quadrance Q1 plus that quadrance Q2 equals the hypotenuse quadrance Q3. And the sister theorem, the triple quad formula, which concerns three points which are collinear. So here are three points, and the three quadrances are that one there is Q1, that one's Q2, and that one's Q3. And the relationship between those three is that Q1 plus Q2 minus Q3 all squared equals 4 times Q1 times Q2. So these are the two main results, and we're going to use them to build up the other three laws. Alright, so the main object of interest is this triangle. So let's just make sure we understand the various ingredients of this triangle. There's vertices A1, A2, A3. There are three quadrances. The quadrance opposite A1 is Q1. It's also Q2 and Q3. There are also three spreads. The spread S1, which is spread between those two lines, the spread S2, and the spread S3. And so our main job is to try to find some relations that involve the quadrances and the spreads. Alright, so we start by making a sort of secondary construction. We drop a perpendicular, say, from A2 to the other side, A1, A3. And we'll call this perpendicular quadrance H. And we'll also call these two quadrances P1 and P3. Alright, let's start now by first examining this right triangle here. The spread S1 is, by definition, H over Q3. It's opposite over hypotenuse quadrants. Similarly, in this triangle here, the spread S3 is, by definition, H over Q1, opposite over hypotenuse quadrants. So we take these two equations and we express H as, first of all, S1 times Q3 and also S3 times Q1. Then we take this expression, just divide by Q1 and Q3 to give S1 over Q1 equals S3 over Q3. So that's the relationship between spreads and quadrances. And because the triangle is completely symmetrical, we can extend it to also equal S2 over Q2. And we write it like this, the spread law. S1 over Q1 equals S2 over Q2 equals S3 over Q3 in any triangle. Now, you may ask, what happens if the triangle is not like this, where the perpendicular here is outside this interval here? That doesn't matter at all. Exactly the same argument still works. That's an aspect of rational trigonometry, that inside and outside play no role. So all the arguments are completely general. All right, so that's our third law. Let's have a look now at the next one. The next one, we start with these two quantities, P1 and P3. In this triangle here, again the right triangle, Pythagoras tells us that P1 is equal to Q3 minus H. But since H is equal to S3 Q1, we can write P1 equals Q3 minus S3 Q1. Similarly, in this triangle here, P3 is equal to Q1 minus H. And so we write P3 equals Q1 minus S3 Q1 again, same expression. Now, these three points are collinear. So these three quadrances, P1, P3, and Q2, must satisfy the triple quad formula, which we write like this. So that's a triple quad formula applied to those three collinear points. P3 plus Q2 minus P1 all squared equals 4 times P3 times Q2. And now what we do is we replace the P's here and here with these expressions. Let's see what happens. So this P3 is replaced by that. So that Q1 minus S3 Q1 comes in there. This P1 is replaced by that expression. So conveniently, the S3 Q1s that appear here and here cancel. And all that we're left with on the left-hand side is Q1 plus Q2 minus Q3 all squared. On the right-hand side, the P3 is this expression here. It factors as Q1 times 1 minus S3. So when we plug that in there, we get 4 times Q1 times Q2 times 1 minus S3. And that's the cross law, the fourth of our main laws. It turns out that all the laws are intimately connected, but this one somehow is the central one. It's probably the most important one. All right, so let's now use the two main laws that we've just established, the spread law and the cross law, to prove the last of the laws. Here is the spread law rewritten. S1 over Q1 equals S2 over Q2 equals S3 over Q3, and we'll write that as 1 over D, where D is some number. That allows us to rewrite these various formulas as Q1 equals S1 times D, so we just take those two and multiply. Q1 equals S1 times D. Also, Q2 equals S2 times D, and at Q3 equals S3 times D. So we have three expressions for Q1, Q2, and Q3, and we plug those in to the cross law. So what happens? Well, this D factor appears on both sides quadratically. So D squared ends up happening on both sides, and we cancel those D squares. And what's left is just a formula involving the S's. S1 plus S2 minus S3 all squared equals 4 times S1 times S2 times 1 minus S3. That is what we might call the triple spread formula, but I usually prefer to think of it in this symmetrical formulation. So I'm going to leave it to you as another important exercise to just rewrite this equation, just using high school algebra, to get it in this symmetrical form. S1 plus S2 plus S3 all squared equals 2 times S1 squared plus S2 squared plus S3 squared plus 4 times S1, S2, S3. And that's very similar to the triple quad formula. If there wasn't this last cubic term, that would be exactly the form of the triple quad formula. Those are the five main laws now. This last one replaces the relationship between the sum of the angles. Now we have all the main laws that we need. There are lots of secondary ones too, but we're going to see that with these laws we can establish a lot of different results and apply the theory to many practical problems. Note, there's no transcendental functions, no tables are needed. The worst any of these formulas is quadratic in any one of the variables. So the quadratic formula is all that you need to do trigonometry using these laws. So as an exercise to get you thinking about these laws and practice them a little bit, here's a triangle, A1, A2, A3, which has quadrances 5, 10, and 13. Okay, so I'm going to leave it as an exercise to calculate these three spreads, S1 here, S2, S3. Here are the values of the three spreads. So you can calculate the values of the three spreads, and you can check that the other laws are also satisfied. That the spread law is satisfied, that the cross law is satisfied, that this triple spread formula is also satisfied. In a subsequent lecture, I'll show you how the 49 appears naturally, naturally related to Heron's formula or Archimedes' theorem. All right, so now we're in a position to do a lot of new things. So next video, we're going to use these laws to do a lot of interesting applications. I'm hoping you're going to join me for that. I'm Norm Wildberger. Thanks for listening.